Spirit's home. Oh, for us. Jehovah, for his name alone is high. Jesus. invites me to call him Father. Only a holy God, come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Come
Jesus. joy of the Lord will be my strength. I will not falter, I will not faint. He is my shepherd, I am not afraid. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord.
Thank you for joining us today. So glad that you've chosen to be a part of this. This morning, we're going to continue our series, Give Thanks to God Our Father. Jonathan's lesson title is Uncommon Gratitude. Let's start off by reading a scripture. It says this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16 through 18. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So glad that you're here. Let's honor and let's praise God.
Good morning. Would you please join me as we go to our Father in prayer? Oh God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for providing us this time of worship where we can praise and honor you. We come before you this morning with our love for you and your Son, Jesus. Please accept our love and adoration as we praise and glorify you. We praise and thank you as our maker, provider, and protector. We are grateful for all that you have given to us, and we realize that all that we have really belongs to you, and that you expect us to use it for your glory. This morning we come together with the unity of our faith and ask that everything we do as your people will be a blessing to those around us and an honor to you. Help us not to succumb to the evil that abounds in our nation and world, but through your light, may we illuminate the lives of those around us. Please bless our nation with peace and love. We also ask you to bless the many people who have requested our prayers this morning. We pray that you bring healing to those who need healing, whether physical or spiritual, and we pray for comfort for those who need comfort. Please bless the following people with whatever they may need. We pray your blessings on Glenn Atkinson, Sylvia Avant, Patsy and Leon Barnes, Karen Brack, David Burt, Ronnie Burt, Clint and Judy Croft, Steve Coycott, Dale Davis, Jeff Davis, Debbie Doss, Dessa Fenter, Terrence Glenn, Adri Gonzalez, Armin Griffith, David Harper, Sharon Hayes, Naylan Hader, Orphy Hernandez, Richard Hooper, Johnny Kylers, Shelby McCurdy, Shirley Norris, Fred Olson, Betty Pope, Jean Porter, Vicki Preston, Kay and Sandra Rollin, Sandy Rutherford and family, Manuel Salinas, Michael Smith, Jean Stone, Guy Stover and family, James Taylor, Edwina Thompson, Alyssa Thompson, Terry Torres, Doyle Vick, Dennis and Marion Valmer, and Bill Yasko. And please be with all of those that are victims of the coronavirus, especially those of our family here at Waters Road. We also pray for the families here at Waters who have members of their family or who are lost or unfaithful. Please provide something or someone in their lives that will touch their hearts to turn to you or to turn back to you. Now we ask that you continue with us throughout this period of worship. May everything that we do and say this morning spur us on to love and good works and bring you all the glory and honor that you deserve. We pray all of this in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Soldiers stripped Jesus and put a scarlet robe on him. They wove a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They mocked him. They spit on him. They took a staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they led him away to crucify him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And with his stripes we are healed.
Good morning. Welcome to Waters Road Church of Christ on this Lord's Day Supper. There are many important things to remember throughout life. It's important to remember the great day of our life. That day would be the day that we were baptized into Christ, become Christian. There are many other days that are important. We remember that's important to us. Our different things in our life that are very important to us. Our family. As Americans, we remember the 4th of July, September 11th. These are important days in our American history. But the most important day to Christians comes around every week on Sunday. On this day, Christians remember Jesus' death and resurrection. Christians honor Jesus' death by sharing the Lord's Supper. Jesus introduced this supper as a reminder in Matthew 26, through 26 through 28, when he took the bread and said, take and eat, this is my body. He also took the fruit of the vine and said, drink from it, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remissions of sins. Sometimes we forget the importance of Jesus dying on the cross for us. We forget he was beaten very harshly. He had to carry the cross on his torn back. And he was spit upon by those that were he was dying for. He suffered so much for his love of mankind. By giving us the Lord's Supper, Jesus helped us to remain in close communication with him every Sunday by remembering the sacrifice that he made for us. Paul told the Christians at Corinth they had become a little lax in their Lord's Supper partaking. And he said, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. He said that in 1 Corinthians 11:26. And on through 29, he told the people of Corinth that they had forgotten the real meaning of the Lord's Supper. And Paul reminded those people that they should be remembering Jesus at that special moment. He told them that if Christians did not eat of the Lord's Supper in a worthy manner, then he would eat and drink judgment to himself in 1 Corinthians 11:29. So, when Christians eat this small amount of bread and drink this cup of juice, we should remember that we do it for a very important reason. We should focus our attention on Jesus and what he did in order that we might be saved for our sins. Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, as we partake of this emblem of bread that represents Jesus' body. We pray, Heavenly Father, you'll be with us as you partake of this. And the things that were just said, that we remember that we take it in a reverent manner and for the reason that he has given to us. We pray that we take of this in his name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we continue, Heavenly Father, we will pray for the cup, and as we do so, let's pray now. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful for this occasion that we have on this first day of the week to come and share this communion with our fellow Christians, and we do this through the vine that represents your body and that the blood that was shed upon that cross. We pray so that we do so in a manner it's pleasing to you, and that we do this every Sunday on the first day of the week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Also, we'd like to take this opportunity to lay by in store, which was given to us for a reason that we should have the opportunity to come back and give Jesus, the Lord, his due and be thankful for the things that we have. Let us pray now for those many things in our lives that we are thankful for. Heavenly Father, we come together on the first day of the week in prayer. Soon we'll be together in person. But as we do this, we are thankful for all the many material things that we've provided for us through many different ways, Heavenly Father. We just are thankful that we're able to give you the honor and glory of the things that we have, and they all belong to you. We pray that we purpose in our heart, Heavenly Father, to give back to you weekly on the first day of the week as we have been blessed. And we're blessed every day, Heavenly Father, and we're just thankful for that opportunity now that we can give back and that we can further your kingdom in this world and help those that are in need. Be with us as we share our giving us this time. Be with us and watch over us, protect us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God has smiled on me. He has set me free. God has Good morning, church. Let us go to our Father in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you now with grateful hearts, thanking you for all the blessings that you have given us. We thank you for being a loving God. Thank you for being a forgiving God. And especially thank you for being our God. We thank you for sending your Son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins, for his love, his compassion, and his commitment to do your will, and to be resurrected from the grave to give us hope. We pray, Heavenly Father, that we can have this kind of commitment so that your love can be seen in us. We pray, Heavenly Father, that we remember that all things come from you, Lord, and that any time we can come to you with our problems, and you will listen any hour, any minute, and any day, and that you will always answer us. Heavenly Father, we pray for peace in all things, peace in our country, peace in our families, peace in your church. And Heavenly Father, we pray that we have peace with you. As we continue our worship today, we pray that you will bless Jonathan as he delivers your word and that we can apply it to our daily lives. Give us strength, Lord, that we will not stray from your will, but we will be encouraging to each other, ready and willing to always help when we are needed. We pray for your continued blessings each day, Lord, and most importantly, that all glory and honor go to you, because you are the Holy One. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. If you'd like to follow along with the scripture reading this morning, it'll be from Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. To Christians who have been forgiven, who have been given a place in heaven, blessed assurance, forgiveness of our sins, we should be the most thankful people in the world. In fact, scripture tells us in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. We can do that in every circumstance because we know that living by faith, God is going to take care of us. As we read the scriptures this morning, I want you to pay particular attention to what occurs as it pertains to thanksgiving. Now it happened as Jesus went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers who stood afar away. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So when he saw them, he said to them, go, show yourselves to the priests. And so it was that they went. They were cleansed. Now one of them, when he saw that he was healed, he returned immediately with a loud voice and glorified God. He fell down on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner? And he said to him, arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well. Thanksgiving. Giving thanks. We have so much to be thankful for, but how often do we pause and just count our blessings and thank God for what he's given us? May God bless you and I in the hearing of his word and in the reading of it. And may we practice in every day, in our everyday life, the giving of thanks to God in everything, knowing that by faith he will make everything in our life good, as he has promised in Romans 8:28. For we know that all things work together for good for those who love the Lord, who have loved his appearing. God bless you.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. O my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship his holy name.
As has already been mentioned, we are so glad that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. Whether you are part of our Waters Road Church family or you are a guest, maybe somewhere here in the state of Texas, the United States, maybe you're in the UK or Canada, wherever you may be this morning, we are honored by your presence. Now, I'd like to encourage you to do two things for me this morning. The first being this, you should keep your Bible or your Bible app opened up to Luke chapter 17. Now, this was the passage of scripture that Mike Prevost read for us just a few moments ago, and we'd like to thank Mike for doing such a fabulous job with today's passage. Now, the second thing I would ask you to do is this. I would ask you to please make sure either you have a copy of today's Bible study outline from our weekly newsletter, or you can scan the QR code that's here on your screen at this time, and you can log in to our interactive sermon notes. Now, either way, we encourage you to follow along and take notes so that you can take to heart what God's Word is saying to you this morning. Now, many of you have heard me talk about my very first car. It was a 1977 Dodge Aspen station wagon, cream colored, much like the car you see here upon your screen. Now, let me share with you just a little bit more about this vehicle. Again, it was my first vehicle. It was the first car that my father ever bought me. We paid $1,000 for this car. It was low mileage for a car of that age, and we were very proud to get it, at least at that very moment. I can remember getting in that car for the very first time, and as a teenager, you know the first thing I did, right? I reached down to turn on the radio, and it did not work. So I knew, taking this off to college, I had to have some tunes, right? So I went down to the local pawn shop, and I found the cheapest used radio I could find. Now, those of you that grew up in that time period in the 70s, you know that car radios, they didn't have all the technology they do today. You didn't have 6 and 7 speakers in that car. No, this is what you had. You had that radio, and you had that one speaker that was in the center of the dash. And I can remember taking it off to college, and I would be on campus, and I'd pull up to a stoplight, and some guy would pull up in his 95 model Mustang, and his radio would be booming. It would go, boom, 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 boom. And here was my radio. And I was so embarrassed by that radio. And I would hate to have my friends in the car because we wanted to listen to tunes. And that was not a great way to listen to tunes. But I can remember one day specifically, I was driving home from college. And about maybe 45 minutes into that trip, you know what happened? That radio quit working. And so for the rest of that trip, I sat in silence. And you know what? The truth is, that is all that had to happen in order for me to learn I needed to be more grateful, that I needed to give thanks for the things that I do have, not just gripe and complain because of the things I do not have. I've learned this. Listen, folks, gratitude does not come naturally to the flesh. It's true. And so today we're going to look at a passage where 10 people are blessed by the Lord, but only one of them comes back to give thanks. Now, this is the second lesson in our Thanksgiving series, and I've entitled this message Uncommon Gratitude. Now, why such a title? Again, folks, let me tell you, because gratitude isn't something that comes naturally to the flesh. So Luke chapter 17, beginning in verse number 11, the first thing we're going to see is this. Number one, jot this down, 10 were healed. Now verse 11 tells us that Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem and that he was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. Now, by the way, why is Jesus on his way to Jerusalem? I think you know the answer. He's headed to the cross. Now, verse 12 says, as he entered a village. Now, he's not in the village yet. He's going into the village. He's on the outskirts of this unnamed village. Now, the rest of verse 12 says he was met by 10 lepers who we are specifically told stood at a distance. Now, let's pause for just a moment. And let's talk about this because there's a lot going on. The Bible is really painting for us a very sad picture. And the first question that ought to come to our mind is, why? Why are these 10 men standing outside the village? Well, the answer is, it's the law. Now, I'm not talking necessarily about governmental law. I'm talking about law with a capital L. I'm talking about the law of God. Now, let me read this for you. It comes from Leviticus chapter 13 and verse 45. It says this, "The leprous person who has the disease shall wear torn clothes and let the hair of his head hang loose, and he shall cover his upper lip and cry out, 'Unclean, unclean,' and he shall remain unclean as long as he has the disease." He is unclean. He shall live alone. Now check this out. Here we go. "His dwelling shall be outside the camp." So these 10 men are congregating outside of this unnamed village, standing at a distance because they're obeying the law of God. But there's another question. Another question that we should probably talk about briefly for just a moment. And that is, what is leprosy? Well, the word here in the Greek, this word is lepra. And it's really a general kind of term for any number of skin diseases. But the most severe of these skin diseases is known as Hansen's disease. And it's really what we call leprosy in our day. And it's most likely what these 10 men had. Now, basically, Hansen's disease, or whatever form of leprosy these men have at this moment, it attacks the skin and the nerves, and you get lesions upon it, your skin, and it disfigures your face, it collapses your nose, it causes folding of the skin. Now, let me tell you this, it doesn't eat the flesh. That's a myth. Folks, again, leprosy does not eat the flesh, but to the loss of feeling in your extremities, your hands, and your feet. The people who had this disease, basically, folks, let me tell you, they would wear away the digits of their hands and their feet unknowingly. And church, it's an absolutely horrendous disease. It's painful. And if you had leprosy, you were cut off from your family and your friends and banned from all society. And, you know, really, we ought to think about this with today's pandemic. There are people that are being isolated from their family and from their friends. And in addition to this, with leprosy in that day, you had this social stigma because their condition was considered to be on them. In other words, you have this because you have sinned against God. That was the common understanding of their day. So people would look at them and cast this divine judgment upon them and say, man, you brought this upon yourself. But think about it. You lose everything. You're in pain. You've lost your friends and your family. And everyone is saying that your own sin has caused this. I mean, we're talking about a very harsh moment in these people's lives. What a harsh picture that's being painted here in Luke chapter 17. And evidently, as Jesus is entering this village, these 10 men are standing again at a distance, but they see Jesus, and look at what they do. They cry out. Look at verse 13. It says this, "Then they lifted up their voices, saying, 'Jesus, Master, have mercy on us.' Then when he," now that's Jesus, "when he saw them, he said to them, 'Go and show yourselves to the priest.' And as they went, they were cleansed." That's amazing, right? As they're walking toward the temple or the synagogue to show the priest, their skin is made whole again. Their leprosy and all of its harsh effects disappears. So in other words, all 10 of these men had a need. All 10 of them brought that need to Jesus, and Jesus met the need of all 10. Now, what was a dreadful picture now is a beautiful picture. In fact, it's an amazing picture that we see here. And when I look at this, I think there are three things that these 10 men had in common that we this morning can learn from. The first thing I see is that with all 10 of these men, write this down, there was desperation. Let me tell you something. Desperate people will do desperate things. In fact, I'm going to tell you something that is an absolute truth. You will never see in your entire life a man or a woman who is drowning ask very casually for help. No, you're going to scream for help. Why? Because you're desperate. Now, I have lived this, folks. I almost drowned as a child. I remember in that moment the desperation that I felt to cry out for someone to rescue me as I was drowning. And thankfully, someone heard my cry and jumped in and saved my life. Folks, that's these guys. I'm telling you, they didn't care where Jesus was going. They didn't care if he was all busy. All they cared about and all they knew was they needed Jesus. Now, I'm going to say this, and I don't want to hurt your feelings, but I think the problem for some of us out there this morning, some of you don't realize how desperately you need Jesus, how desperately we need Jesus in our lives. So because of that, we don't cry out to Jesus. We don't call out to him. But the truth is, without Jesus, folks, you are in a desperate situation. The wrath of the living God rests upon you. And folks, it doesn't get more desperate than that. The second thing they have in common is this. They all cried out for mercy. Jot this down. There was a cry for mercy. Now, I absolutely love, I love, love, love the way they articulated their need. They're yelling, and the first word they cry, look at this, Master. Now, check it out, church. That is a really odd word to use here, especially in the Greek. It's called epistates. Epistates. That's the word in the Greek. Now, here's the weird thing about it. This word is only found in the Gospel of Luke. And when it's found, it always refers to Jesus. And this is the only time in the entire Bible that someone other than Jesus' disciples ever cries out and uses this word, Master. And the word is applied to someone who has power, someone who has authority. And you know what? That lets us know something about these lepers. They knew who Jesus was, or at least they had heard about him, right? So they cry out, they say, Master, and then they cry out, have mercy on us. Let me paraphrase that for you. They're saying, hey, Jesus, we need mercy. Our disease is incurable. Our situation is hopeless and our lives are miserable. Have mercy on us. Heal us. There's one final thing that I want you to see these 10 men do in unison. Look at this. Jot this down. There was obedience. So beautiful. Check it out. So Jesus, he doesn't heal them immediately right there, does he? No. Instead, he told them to do something. You've got to do something. You've got to obey my instructions. And what does he say? He says, go and show yourself to the priest. Once again, Leviticus. This time, Leviticus chapter 14 says, in order to be declared cleansed, you had to go see a priest. Now, I want you to remember, this is the law. the law with a capital L, the law of God. Now, it's important as well, I think, that we remember the details here. Sometimes we do forget the details here, and that is that the healing, again, did not take place until they obeyed the command. They did not get their healing until they were what? Obedient. Had they not obeyed Jesus, I think you and I can see they would not have been cleansed by Jesus. Now, that speaks very powerfully to me, and I hope it speaks powerfully to you as well, because you cannot, nor should you, ever expect blessings from God when you walk in willful disobedience. I mean, when you are living a life of unrepentant sin, do not be surprised that you're not living the abundant life. I'm just telling you this morning, and in the case of the 10 lepers, again, the blessing came after they were obedient. Now, here's where this entire scene is going to shift, because although 10 of these men had these three things in common, one of these men is about to do something very uncommon. He's going to say, thank you. Uncommon gratitude. So let's contrast the picture now, because I can tell you, this passage sure does paint the contrast. You've got this one picture that we've just looked at, and these 10 men and the three things they have in common. Now, let's contrast it with this other picture, because we're going to see how one of these 10 men received more than healing. And that is this. Number two, jot this down. One received salvation. Now, verse 15, let's keep going here in this passage. It says, and then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back praising God. Now, here we go once again, and it finishes up with what? With a loud voice. Now, one of them, as they're walking towards this synagogue, this temple, he looks down and he sees that his hands are healed and that his skin that was so scarred now looks pristine and beautiful, and it causes him to do something different than all the other 9 men. Now, up to this point, again, they're unified. They've been acting in unison. But when they find this healing, one of them does something different. Again, let's look at verse number 16, and it says, and he, that's the one that was healed, okay, fell on his face. Where? At Jesus' feet. And then what does he do? Gives him thanks. Now, this man is like, listen, I don't care who's around. Everybody is going to hear me give thanks to God. They're going to hear me praising God. And to me, this is such a beautiful picture. In fact, you know what, good folks? We could have an entire worship service, and where all we do is give our thanks to God. Why? Because giving thanks to God, or in this case, giving thanks to Jesus, it glorifies God. But I want you to look at the rest of verse number 16, because we see something else here. It's an interesting thing. It tells us this man is a Samaritan. Now, that's curious. Why does the Bible give us this piece of information? I mean, Jonathan, does it really matter? Yes, it absolutely does matter, because we're meant to see something here. Again, Jews and Samaritans, what do you know about them? Well, I can tell you this one thing. They hated one another, and Jews would not have expected in any way for God to heal or especially save a Samaritan. But in the book of John, in the Gospel of John, Jesus saves many Samaritans in the Samaritan village. And let me tell you, the first person whom Jesus revealed that he was the Messiah, do you remember John chapter 4? The Samaritan woman. Now, here we see the fact that nobody. Folks, let me tell you again, nobody is outside of Jesus' power to heal and save. Don't forget it. Jesus has always been working among the nations, and he continues to do so even now. So this man that we're looking at is saying, thank you. Now we get to verse 17, because now Jesus has got some questions. And I want you to notice these questions. The first question, then Jesus answered, verse number 17, were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Jesus is like, now wait, hey, wait a second, y'all. I thought there were 10 of you. Did I not heal 10 of you? Where are the other 9? Now, the Bible doesn't give us the answer. The Bible doesn't tell us at that very moment where the other 9 are at. But let me tell you, I know what they were doing. Or at least I have a pretty good guess. Because you know what? The truth is, we've done the same thing. I've done the same thing. They were out enjoying their blessings. So much so that in the process, they forgot to thank the blesser. I mean, you've been there, I've been there, we've been enjoying the blessings and we forget to thank the blesser, or enjoying the gift and forgetting to thank the gift giver. And look at verse 18, because Jesus has got another question. He says this, was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Verse number 19, and he said to him, rise and go your way. Your faith, folks, that's saving faith, has made you well. Now, church, I'm begging you this morning, if you haven't done so already, underline that phrase, made you well. And see, that's really curious. Because it's not the same word or the same phrase used in verse 14. In verse 14, it says they were cleansed. But in verse 19, it says that he was made well. And that is two completely different words, especially in the Greek language. Now, this phrase, made well, man, we could go into it. We could study it for several minutes. But let me tell you, basically what it's saying is, you have been saved. You have been saved from your sins. You have been made completely well. Now, if this were the Jonathan Sanford translation, I'd put it this way. I'd say 10 were made well. Truly one was made cleansed. Now, see, the truth is, this man alone received the second miracle. The greater miracle, in fact, the greatest miracle, and that was salvation from his sins. So real quick, three lessons that I think we can compare and contrast to the first point about this uncommon gratitude. And the first thing we see here is this. Write this down, jot this down. All the lepers were blessed. Now, I want us to understand, I want us to get a hold of this. Again, they were all blessed, right? There's no doubt about it. And they should have all 10 given thanks. It's true of the 10 lepers, but it's also true of us today. And folks, as the church, we ought to be the most thankful of all. In fact, you know what? The scripture makes it clear that as Christians, we are to be marked by our gratitude, that it should be, it's supposed to distinguish us from this world. I want to say it again, being grateful, being thankful is a prerequisite to our existence and especially our worship. But what we do see here are three things. Let me share these with you. We've looked at the first one again. All the lepers were blessed. The second is this. Not all of the lepers gave thanks. Now the other 9, what did they do? Let me tell you, they went about their business. They went back to their homes. They probably gave an offering. They did all the religious stuff. They dotted every I. They crossed every T. But you know what they didn't do? They did not return to Jesus. And the final thing we see here And jot this down. One was completely healed. Now, the other nine, I think no doubt they intended to go back and do the religious activity. Maybe the offering. Do those religious things. But once again, only one returned to worship God in the Christ. As Colossians says, in whom all the fullness of deity dwells, only one returned to worship. So here's the lesson for you this morning. I believe here in this very brief passage, Jesus is teaching us Christians. He's teaching us that where there is true faith, saving faith, you will find profoundly grateful people. God's people are to be a thankful people. We are to express uncommon gratitude. But I'm going to ask you this question as we close. Does the nine describe you? Are you dotting every I, crossing every T, attending every worship service, but you're missing the one thing that separates you and distinguishes you from this world? Are you missing the gracious heart of thanks that it requires to truly worship God? I hope that you, in this morning's life, the day that you are living on this day forward, you would be described as someone who shows uncommon gratitude, that the one describes you, not the nine. Uncommon gratitude.
Gentle shepherd.
Shepherd, come and
Church family, as we conclude this time of worship together this morning, we are excited to share with you that next Sunday, November the 22nd, beginning at 10 a.m., we will reassemble for in-person worship at our building at 3616 Waters Road in Pasadena. We're excited about being together next Sunday morning and concluding our Thanksgiving series. You know, over the last 3 weeks, we have dealt with some very tough issues concerning COVID-19 within our church family, but we're hearing good reports about a lack of COVID-19 within our church family, and so thus, Lord willing, we will reassemble next Sunday, November 22nd, at our building for in-person worship. If you can be with us, we will be delighted to see you. But if you cannot, we also will continue to offer our live stream for you. We look forward to having each of you be with us next Sunday. That's next Sunday, November the 22nd. As we close this morning, let us spend a few moments in prayer. Father, we're grateful for your presence with us on this Lord's Day. Whether we be in our homes or whether we be in a building, Father, we know that your Spirit is here with us, Father, as we praise your name and offer up thanksgiving for the blessings that you have truly given us in abundance. Father, as we close our worship, we pray that the things that we've done, Father, has been edifying to one another, but most of all, pleasing to you, Father. It is our desire to please you in everything that we do. But we know, Father, that it must start with a grateful heart. We're grateful for your grace, for the salvation made possible by your Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, we ask that during this holiday season, we might express our thanks and our gratitude. Maybe it's uncommon, Father, in this world, but may it be common among us as God's family. May it distinguish us from the world, and may it be a light to others that they may glorify and praise your name. Father, forgive us the many ways that we fall short of the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ. We're thankful for his sacrifice that we've been able to remember on this Lord's Day. Father, again, we thank you for being with us as a church family, for helping us to navigate through a very difficult time with COVID-19, for having this way of conducting our worship together, even though, Father, we so look forward to next Sunday, if it be your will, and us being together in person. Father, we conclude our time of worship this morning knowing that there are those out there among us that are truly struggling with COVID-19. And we're thankful that of our church family, those who have been infected have been healed and are, Father, leaving it behind, Father, and hopefully on their way to full recovery. Father, I pray that you'd be with those families who are dealing with other illnesses that were named earlier in our Shepherd's Prayer. Father, I pray that we might keep them in our hearts and that your healing might be upon each and every one. Father, we thank you again for this time of worship that we have been able to assemble together to be part of. And it is in through the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
I'm gonna trade my earthly home for a better one, bright and fair. Christ left to prepare a mansion for his children in the air. I'll join him in that land where tears nor sorrows can be found, and I'll receive my mansion,
robe
and crown.
Mansion,
robe and a crown.
Bowed
and bloody now from the work that I've tried to do, but one day.
The altar of our praise, let there be no higher.